because this is a part of the problem. So let's look at the Industrial Revolution. So the Industrial Revolution was a time when we went from a cottage industry, what I like to call Mrs. London's, to one of mass production. And this change depended on a number of factors, including the concept of industrial production, the suitability of activities for industrial production, the technology to achieve it, and finally, a willingness Now, this concept is the concept behind cloud computing. It's at heart. But the question always was, when will IT activities be suitable for this strategy? When will they do for products or services? Well, could we somehow work out this process? Well, the answer is yes, we can. And I'm going to draw a graph and another graph. I'm going to draw a graph of ubiquity from something modern, like a good film with Tom Cruise in, to something wrong, like a film with Tom Cruise in. And it gives us a lot of certainty to something which I don't think, like when I'm going to finish this presentation on time, to something which I do know, how much time I've got left. And then we're going to add still later. So this is teasing the first part of the X axis. And what this hypothesizes is there's an S-curve relationship between ubiquity and certainty of an activity. It shows a path how rarely an innovation becomes more of a commodity, eventually using utility-like services. Now, we can see this analogy because it's something like CRM. Everything in IT is going that way. That's all transmission of all IT is the same. But you have a broad spectrum of activities in IT, and it's only some of those activities which have become suitable for a service world. However, some of them have become suitable. So we've got concept and we've got suitability. That's not enough. We also need the technology to achieve it. Now, one of the technologies behind this is virtualization. Virtualization, the reality is popular on the subject in 1934. So yes, for sure, but virtualization has been around for some time. So in the words, it's not it, you have the technology. But this isn't enough. Producing the change in attitude. Well, the attitude of business has been changing to IT. This is a challenge for this car. Wrote several books pointing out that there was little strategic value. As IT activities become ubiquitous, they have diminishing strategic value. They become much more of a cost of doing business. And business is much more aware of this. It doesn't mean all activities, of course, there are certain activities. So you've got concept of ubiquity, technology, and change of attitude. And this is what is driving cloud computing and this shift from product to service world. So a quick recap. Using the example of the electricity industry, the concept of commoditisation and how business activities are moving along this curve from innovation to much more of a common service. This change is happening in IT today. It was first predicted back in the 1960s by John McCarthy. Now, it's a combination of the concept plus suitability of activities plus the technology plus the change in business attitude. Very disruptive for anybody who's in this industry is a
to the organization of the subsystems. And this is an idea known as commoditisation. Now, to explain it, let's consider the computer stack. If you have a CPU, MI, virtualization, and operating systems, we build on top of that, that basically works like S users, and on top of that, the applications and data services we run. And it's faster to write an application using stable components than it is to write an application by first designing the CPU, memory, and IO, and its operating system. And the orders of magnitude are hundreds of thousands of dollars. So I want to put this together. So I'm going to take this meeting that, which for brevity, are called infrastructure, platform, and application. And I will consider the shift of this from a product to a service world. What does that actually mean? For example, infrastructure. What does that mean? Well, if you consider how I go about building a 10-machine environment in a product world, I have to first of all go and buy something that has to share, it has to get a box, I have to install it. However, in a service world, I just have to find a provider. I run something in client. This is a huge difference between a product and a service world. It is the difference between physical, where infrastructure is physical, the service world, where infrastructure is no more computer. This is why the shift of that computing stack towards standardized components provided as online services accelerates massively the rate of innovation we have in their IT. The second observation that I'd like to make concerns innovation. These ideas were described by Edward Rawls in the Fusion Innovation. However, whilst these changes be radically disruptive in innovation, there's simply improvements to an existing activity. They didn't recreate the original innovation of that activity. A better CRM doesn't recreate the original innovation of that CRM. Why is that matter? Why is that important? Well, there's a danger. Because a lot of people are trying to describe and computing as something negative. But it really represents a natural evolution of industry. Why does that matter? Well, innovation is something which is uncertain. It requires deviation from what previously exists. It's a differential between you and something else. And it's a source of wealth. But something which is more of a commodity is defined. It can't have deviation. It's a long operation. It's more of a cost of doing business. We can build it if it just should be on the cost. So when it comes to computing, what you should be thinking of is the value that you will create as in users by the faster innovation. cost. Now, a computer should provide you with that in terms of your implementation of your ideas, but it means treating that client as you need to focus on pricing quality of service. Now, I want to look at the benefits and risks of client confusion. So, the benefits and lots of people talk about it is a pretty straightforward economies of scale through volume operations, deep use utility technology, faster speed to market commoditisation, and also you get focus on core activities like outsourcing that which is not core. This is what people commonly say. So, what about the risks? Well, here's one risk. It's the risk of doing nothing. If you treat an activity as though it's an innovation, where in fact it's a commodity, the only thing you're going to create is a competitive disadvantage for yourself. As the market becomes more efficient, you need to keep up. And this creates a constant pressure for everybody to keep up with the rest of the market. And the analogy to explain this is I'll go back to my cat fight. There is no point in turning up to the cat fight with a snazzy rifle if everyone else has brought the tank. All organizations need to constantly evolve in order to keep up with the surroundings. This is actually going to require a process. So the benefits of cloud computing, whether people like it or not, are going to drive the industry to adopting this change. There's two other types of risks. One risk is related to the disruptive shift of products or service world. These are transitional risks. This includes things like governance. And there's a big one here called transparency, which almost nobody talks about. And because nobody talks about it, and all these things I thought about how to get it. So, I'm going to use an analogy again. I'm going to imagine that Chapel Jones is 70% of us as an infrastructure as a service provider. So, he goes out there, buys lots of hardware, adds the virtualization magic to it as well, and creates lots of virtual machines, which you can sell forward to other people. Okay, Tom is himself up as an online storage service provider, and he's going to use some of Joe's virtual machines. Dick is going to set himself up as a platform, as a service provider, or as a common Google Pass, and he decides to build on some of this platform on some Joe's virtual machines as well. Harry decides to create an online mapping service, and he's going to use some of the storage from Tom's online service as well. Whilst Alice decides to set up as a software as a service provider or SaaS, selling a transport routing application, which is going to use some hack mapping API, some Tom storage, and also the base platform. And Bob runs a portal. And Bob is going to rent Alice's transport routing application. So this is actually an action. Think of examples. Takes out lots of mortgages to buy a big number of houses. And then Tom takes all these mortgages and gives them into a security, which they then subdivide to different Well, this gambler's got caught out by a lack of transparency. And you will too. The other group of risks to do with computing is the pricing competition the market? Is there locking? Are you being tied into a vendor? Do you have second sourcing options? But all of these create adoption barriers for the path. But it's not really a question of if you're going to develop computing. It really is a question of when. It's a question of balancing the competitive costs on most organizations of using the path extend beyond them. It's not so much what's in them, but what's left out of them. That's the problem. The only way of actually creating a competitive marketplace in this space is if standards are actually based upon open source reference models, i.e. running code. Now, this is one of the big problems we face today. Because open source is really doing well in the prospect of the background shifting to much more of a service model. And this world is heavily dominated by proprietary systems. And some work and some progress is being made. We have, for example, an open source equivalent of EC2, as we call it. We have an open source feedback engine, which is App Store. But we don't have the open source equivalent of Windows as well. There are many areas which are weak in this space. This really is where the battle is going to be for the future of software distribution. And so that's the battle. Thank you. Now, some of you can actually make this with time. So, so I'm actually a huge fan of GDLP3 as the right standard. There are lots of different reasons why we use GDLP3, why we put in the point of view of very protective marketplaces and standards. So I would say GDLP3 is the right answer. Does that make sense? Yes. Your answer. is there is a number of providers in the architect which fits for hardware on a cloud base. I mean, you think it's a spring transition. So all sorts of new methodologies are coming to the fore. So there is a European design. Other questions?
Yes.
No, as you presented, it reminded me of the last of the context, which was an operating system idea from the 1960s, and then being replaced by Unix, because personal computers became too cheap for the markets that they would. So there's no idea why this will work out.
Okay, so this is a book actually, that was from 1966, The Challenge of Computing Utility. Certain activities, there are constant creation of new services, new concepts, new ideas to the IT. Now, whilst those new concepts or new ideas may not be suitable for being provided on as a service basis, they will use various subsystems, such as database frameworks, messaging systems, storage level, which are suitable for being provided by a platform. So, it's not a And It's a long-term paradox between the need to balance order and disorder in an organization in order to survive tomorrow and in order to survive today. And apparently, it was okay whilst everybody else was making a using some process. The problem is when people start to change it up more efficient, means that other organizations have to lose seats as well. Does that make sense? Yes? In a nutshell. Oh my God. Okay, well, it's all